All right. Well, there's nothing here to value in this world, simply because nothing here changes what we are. So this world's a total failure, actually. And we're depressed because we're like, wow, I haven't been able to change what I am. What was this world for anyway? What a waste. What a waste of time and effort. My gosh. So I'm going through this phase of like depression. And what you have to do is you have to be patient. You have to be in the mood of repentance. Because depression will hit at times. Because how depressing is it to realize that all of this world, making all this, is totally in vain. It was totally in vain. Didn't change what we are at all. We're still completely formless. In spite of all this form, what we are is still completely formless. And yeah, it's very depressing, actually. No value to anything, right? I mean, we made everything to try to change what we are. It doesn't work. What value is there? What value does it have for us? No value at all. Useless. Totally useless. Useless world. That's... I have to bring some humor into it. Because I've been very depressed. And saying, why am I so depressed? I don't understand. And it just came to me suddenly. None of this has worked. We're still formless. We're still formless. The oneness is still the oneness. Boy, and we really conjured up some very nasty stuff, right? And you would think that some of that would work. Mosquitoes are starting to bite now. Some of these would have worked. Something would have worked. We got all this terrible suffering and terrible people and terrible relationships and terrible everything and death and all these forms, you know, conflicting and clashing. And none of it has done anything at all. Nothing at all. So as soon as I get, we'll see how this depression, how it goes. I don't know how it's going to go. Hopefully it will resolve. Trying to get it to resolve as fast as possible. By talking about it, yeah, nothing has worked. How do you feel about that? Nothing has worked. You might think that we'd be happy, but no. I mean, when you put that much effort into something, you know, how can you be happy that it didn't work? I know theoretically we should say, oh, we're happy that we weren't able to destroy ourselves. But just the massive, incredible effort and investment in trying to change what we are, just feeling that was all just a complete waste, futile, never succeeded at all. Very depressing. And so we have to allow for that depression. The mood of repentance is very helpful. You just have to stay calm, non-reactive, non-suicidal, non-self-destructive, non-angry. Even though there's simmering and bubbling underneath, you just have to stay with it, stay observing it. Keep the attitude of an observer, just observing the reactions to it. And everything we've done, from the first microbe, first atom, first microbe, all through the evolution of form, and everything we've done has been totally futile. As I'm just looking at that, it's helping lift the depression. I'm thinking, why can't I just be aware of the living light, the formless living light as my companion? It's because that brings the realization that everything we've done is futile. We'll always be futile, trying to change what we are. And so that kind of gets in the way of experiencing the light. And I'm wondering, how come I can't be positive? Well, it's hard to be positive when you see that all of time is a waste of time. And but I'm getting there. If you start thinking about it, so you can break it down into well, okay, there's a year of futility, a futile form. 10 years. Maybe this tree's been here 50 years. Well, 50 years, okay. 50 years even trying to change what we are. Okay, that's not very long. Maybe 100 years, a century. Take it a century. Can I accept that the century's not too long? I've been trying for a century to change what I am with all these forms. How about 2 centuries? How about 3 centuries? Okay, still not so bad. How about 5 centuries? How about 10 centuries? 1,000 years. See, 1,000 years of this, and maybe 10,000 years. 10,000 years. So start to stretch it out a little bit. 1,000,000 years. 1,000,000,000 years. And if we could somehow get our minds around time, which I believe is possible, I'm feeling it, then we would just say, well, it's not that big of a deal, it's possible. Somehow we get tripped up by what? What year trips us up? Is year number, 680,423 or something? What about the 424? Does that trip us up there? Or where are we tripped up as far as saying, I just can't bear that I spent that year, that one extra year on it? So when you get a heavy depression like this, you think it's unsolvable. And I've been certainly thinking that this day, it's unsolvable. It seems too enormous, but then starting to look at it in terms of years, well, it's just been just this quote-unquote time frame. And what is it about the time frame that makes it so depressing? Everything I've tried to do well, where does the depression set in? After 1 year of effort, 2, 3, 4, 5, and look at it like that. And try to, somehow shrink it down. Shrink it down. That's what I call them shrinks. You're able to shrink your problem down. You see, a good shrink can get you to look at the problem, which seems the reason why we get trapped, we see these problems, they seem just enormous and too big, and we just can't. But if you shrink it down, then it's like, wow, the depression can dissipate. I mean, a good shrink is a good shrink, whether they have a diploma or not. So we're trying to be a good shrink here, and trying to be my own shrink, and shrink the problem down, shrink the dismay down, actually. Let's say I just played at it for 5 years. Is that such a big deal? 5 years of playing with form, and say, oh, it didn't work. I've kind of fiddled around with it for I fiddled around with it for 500 years. Didn't work. Fiddled around with it for 5,000 years. That didn't work. Fiddled around with it for 50,000 years. It didn't work. Okay. Fiddled around with it for 500,000 years, and so that. There, I start to feel, something between 50,000 and 500,000. So, fiddled around with it for 100,000 years. See, and that starts also the feeling. 50,000, it's okay. So that there's some jump, in there. Feeling like, wow, that's too long. I feel depressed. Whereas 50,000, that's not so bad. Not so bad. was really depressed today because I had an abscess and his jaw had infected and brought it to the vet and they cleaned it out and they said, yeah, it should be okay. And so, and he's actually feeling a lot better now. So he was very depressed this morning and now he's back, you know, to his old self. So maybe I can get back to my old self too. Years of fiddling around, 50,000 years of failure, and I can't seem to get past that. Okay, so 50,000 years once, 50,000 years twice, did 50,000 years twice, 50,000 years three times, 50,000 years four times, maybe 50,000 years 50,000 times. Not so bad. Still seems like a lot though. That seems to be oppressive right there. So there's a certain point where something seems oppressive, where before it doesn't seem that way. We really need a spiritual shrink in this world to tell you the truth. That is a fact. Here comes the cat. That is a fact. We need a spiritual shrink in the world. Very much so. Because it is something of perception. Like at some point something becomes too oppressive. Like we spent too much time wasting time. How much time is too much time wasting time, you see? And they say, oh, I'm depressed. I can't feel happy about that. I can't let it go and feel happy about it. I've got to be depressed about it, be angry about it. You really need more than just someone saying, see the one. Yeah, really. Just see the one. Well, yeah, I get it. I mean, I get all that. But what about all the time we've spent not seeing the one? You know, we're trying to change the one. It didn't work. That's the regret for having wasted so much time. That's a major block. Now the Holy Spirit is supposedly the best shrink there is. So I'm asking the Holy Spirit to shrink this one down for me. Need to shrink it down definitely. It can do it. I've noticed some amazing changes, flip flops, by asking the Holy Spirit to change my perspective on something. Feel very much oppressed by something, and then later on just feeling like, wow, I feel absolutely great. So I've noticed that the Holy Spirit actually is capable of this. Really, it is. It's the ultimate shrink, actually. So you might want to try that when you feel oppressed, something that's very oppressive. It's because it just seems like it's gone on too long, too much. That kind of thing. It just you feel like, wow, it gets you down. At some point you get down, and the world actually right now is extremely oppressive. I find I just everywhere you look is just this deadness of just superficial form worshiping deadness everywhere, and at some point it becomes oppressive, doesn't it? It's just like, wow, I feel so depressed because it's too much. So we have to go turn to the shrink and it can do the job. Holy Spirit can do the job. You just ask the Holy Spirit, lift my spirits, change this oppression into a feeling of liberation. Liberate me from this oppression. Now there's nothing more oppressive than realizing that everything you've ever done and imagined to try and change what you are has had absolutely no effect whatsoever. And of course, when you are aware of the formless light, you will see that. And you will see that there's never any possibility of accomplishing anything. There's nothing to collapse there. How can you collapse formlessness? You can only collapse form, right? So when we wanted to try and collapse formlessness, what do? Well, we symbolized it as form, and then collapsed form, and said, aha, you see, I'm collapsing formlessness. And then now you realize, oh, that was just a silly waste of time. Formlessness has never been touched by any of that. Idiocy. We've been idiots for a long time, and that's how do you get see that in a humorous light? That's the job of the Holy Spirit. That's the genius of the Holy Spirit. So I'm just hoping by tomorrow I feel on top of the world, or liberated from the world. Very possible. I expect it will happen. Holy Spirit will find a way. It always has ways that we cannot understand. It's really quite the orchestrator. And then you just help others, shrink their problems down too. Shrink that feeling down too, so it is no longer oppressive, and they can break free of that oppression, that heavy weight of oppression. It's a very oppressive weight that I'm feeling, of futility. Doesn't matter how long you suffer, doesn't do anything to reality, to our formless identity. Doesn't do anything. There's no way we can attack at this. There's no form to attack. How can we define attack against formlessness? Well, we define it as causing it to take on form. That's how we, but it has never taken on form, not really. We've simply defined it as if it were, perceiving as if it were, believing that it is. But it's everything is actually just light. It's not really form. There's really no such thing as form, actually, technically speaking. It's just relativism will say, well, you could say that this is more towards form than something else that's, not as frozen. But, like an ice cube is more towards form than water. But nothing, there is no actual form. It's all formless light. But there's sort of this perception gives us a mirage, as if there was form. So we all need this psychiatrist of the Holy Spirit, the ultimate psychiatrist, the ultimate shrink. Let's see how it does in my case here. Got to be fast. Cannot afford to be depressed at this point in time. This weight of oppression has to lift. I just ask it to lift this weight of oppression off of me. Absolutely. And we'll see what happens. That's a simple prayer. Holy Spirit, lift this weight of oppression off of me. It knows what the oppression is, the feeling. Can definitely turn things around. So we'll see what happens. This is a very interesting video and a very, very interesting setup for down the road. For sure, you everyone will run into feelings of oppression. Stay patient. Stay confident. And it's frustrating because you think you should be able to get it by now, but that with the weight of oppression is very heavy upon us. Very heavy. It takes some kind of very interesting orchestration to get free of that weight of oppression. The weight of the ages, you know, weighs heavily upon us. The weight of everything that we've all the symbolization we've done, all the imagination and symbolization seems to be heavy upon us. Because it's heavy upon us because it's not heavy upon our identity at all. It's not touching in the slightest bit. There's never been the slightest weight of oppression upon our true identity at all. Never. And so we're holding on to this feeling of heavy oppression, hoping that it will have some effect. So it could go just like that, because there's no actual momentum to anything. There's just the hope that there's momentum, that we've generated some momentum. But it's really we've just generated this feeling of oppression, severe oppression, hoping that it can weigh on ourselves, our true identity, and weigh it into form. There's a weight, a pressure upon it. All right, so just see how this goes. Just see how it goes. I know the oppression will lift. I know the oppression will lift. Just have to see it in the right light. And okay. All right, let's see what happens. That's it. All right, back. Back and better than ever. What a difference half a day makes. I said that I'll ask the Holy Spirit for help. Well, I've got the help. And it's ongoing. The song of salvation is, I'm hearing the song of salvation clearer than ever before. And I understand now why I was a little bit despondent. Or at least despondency was trying to grip me, saying, you must be despondent. This must be your reaction to what you're hearing. And I say, no, that's not my reaction at all. There's no reaction like that. Pushed it away. So, The song of salvation is what the Holy Spirit sings, and it's music to your ears. What does it boil down to? Before we get to that, let us remember that the mood of repentance is the most important discipline and attitude that we must have. Mood of repentance essentially is to say to yourself, you know what I'm going to hear and see when the song of salvation is sung to me, I'm going to be stunned by it. I am going to be floored by it. I'm going to be stunned for sure. Therefore, what we do is ahead of time, we put ourselves into this mood as if we are absorbing something very stunning. Let's say if you're a worker and you have to lift something really heavy. Well, you got to get into the mental mood of lifting heavy stuff. If you're not in that mood, you can't really galvanize yourself properly, actually. Well, you get yourself in the mood, this is going to be a strain, a real strain, and I know it, and I'm prepared. My energy, my focus, everything is aligned with that, and I can absorb the strain because there's not some part of me that's not awake to this. So, in listening to the song of salvation, we have to be in this mood, focus, saying, "This is really going to floor me. What I hear is really going to just be so stunning." So I want to align myself and prepare myself for being stunned. And there's no question that what I heard this morning, very stunning. But I said, I love it. Keep on singing. Keep on singing. I want to keep hearing this song of salvation. This is wonderful. Great news. Great news. But also very stunning. So when you go anywhere where you want to hear the song of salvation, which is the reason why you watch this video or go to looking for truth anywhere, you have to be in this mood of I'm going to be really stunned, shocked, stunned, wow, when from what I hear. And when you're in that mood, that enables you then to hear it. Otherwise, you won't really hear it. Because you'll say, oh, I don't really want to be stunned right now. I'm too busy trying to what? Well, that's the question. Too busy trying to do what? Too busy trying to perceive oneness is the answer to that question. Yes, oneness cannot be perceived. Okay, oneness cannot be perceived. And this is the stunning. This is part of the stunningness of what I have to share here. What are bodies? Bodies are the attempt to perceive oneness. That's all the bodies are. We have tried to develop a perception of oneness. And that attempt has to develop a perception of oneness is what we call animate forms, bodies, consciousness. That's an attempt to perceive oneness. Consciousness is an attempt to perceive oneness. And these bodies are an attempt to perceive oneness. That's all they are. That's their sole purpose, is to perceive oneness. Oneness cannot be perceived. Therefore, bodies are useless. That is true. Entirely useless, except as a communication device to confirm to other aspects of spirit, confirm to the oneness that, hey, oneness cannot be perceived, bodies are useless, as a communication device to convey the great good news, actually. Other than that, bodies are entirely useless. That's what I saw this morning. And intuitively, I knew this is correct. This is absolutely correct. They're entirely useless. Oneness cannot be perceived. Oneness can never be an object of perception. Oneness is only known. It's never perceived. Yeah, so we're in no hurry here. This is stunning. I'm saying the body is useless. All bodies are useless. That is very true. Bodies are nothing more than the attempt to perceive oneness. That's all. That's all that bodies are for. Now we have this great myth that we're perpetuating of how important bodies are. Because, see, we want to say that we're greater than God. That means we're greater than the oneness. So we want to objectify the oneness and say, sure, there's the oneness, but we're greater, we're perceiving the oneness, and we're beyond the oneness, we're greater than the oneness. Therefore, we're trying to develop a means to see it, to perceive it. Oneness cannot be seen, cannot be perceived. It can be only known. Just absorbing this. Now, the benefit of being in the mood of repentance, of absorbing the shock, is questions don't arise. What happens when you get into this frantic questioning mode, it means you're panicking and you weren't prepared for the shock to be stunned by the song of salvation. And so you're buying time. That's what happens. You're saying, whoa, wait a minute, I need to buy some time. Let me ask questions. That makes things even worse. So, but when in the mood of repentance, saying, yeah, I'm going to be really shocked and stunned by what I hear, and I accept that, and I'm willing to absorb that, then all these quibbles and frivolous questions, you see them, they say, no, that's not important to even ask that question or pursue that question. It's not important. Absorbing the shock is what's important. Bodies are useless. The entire attempt to perceive oneness is nothing, totally useless. Now, bodies did not do this themselves. We're the ones who are imagining bodies. Bodies don't have any identity, separate will or identity or anything like that. The ego says, well, if you realize bodies are useless, bodies will commit suicide. Not true. That's a lie. Spirit may be angry or frustrated or shocked and feel depressed or something for a little while, but it's not bodies. There isn't any inherent suicidal reaction from bodies at all. I've been feeling, you know, some depression. But that's in my mind, that's in my spirit saying, wow, all along this has all been completely useless, yeah. But there's more of a like, wow, this is great. I think this is really a breakthrough. And we're in the time now, the cult of the body, the cult of the form, trying to reinvest in the belief that bodies are useful because that they're the means to perceive oneness. Not true, never will be true. How can oneness be perceived? From what vantage point can it be perceived? From what vantage point can it be an object of perception? There isn't any. Now, there was a whole bunch of insight before this popped. Finally, I heard this truth. I went through a process of consideration, and then this truth: bodies are useless. You cannot perceive. Oneness cannot be perceived. Ah, you know, that was like the key insight, the heavy insight. But there was a lot of insight that preceded that this morning. I was listening to this song, and then it got to the really strong part of the song. See, bodies are not self-conscious, self-aware. They don't have they don't know what their mission is or anything like that. Their body's really nothing. It's a projection. It's mind that is desiring to perceive oneness. So it is imagining that this is a means to, bodies are this means to perceive oneness. Now the thing is for spirit not to blame a particular body and saying, oh, well, this body's no good, this body's useless, I'm going to get another one. See, that's where the problem lies, right? And this world tells us, if you say, well, this body's useless, they'll say, well, no, speak for yourself, your body's useless, so you should go get another body, meaning commit suicide, get born again, get a new body, and they say that body will be useful to you. That's not true. Nobody is useful whatsoever. Oneness can never be perceived in any way, shape, or form. Totally impossible. So the suicidal impulses come from the collective demand of the desire to be greater than God, claiming you must perceive oneness. Therefore, if you're saying that your body cannot perceive it, you must get another body. And if you say your body's useless, might as well set it down now immediately and take another birth and get another body. And I say, no to that, you see. So there is a depressive component to this, if you do not take the spiritual path in the right way, of the mood of repentance and willing to absorb this, you know, being stunned like wow, in a positive light, saying this is great, this being stunned is wonderful, and you respond to it in that way, then the depressive demand, you know, won't get to you. Because you're saying, I'm useless. All bodies are useless. All perception is useless. Perception is useless, has no use. Has no use at all. Never has had a use. It's useless from the beginning. Now, I could feel the liberation of this as I was hearing the Song of Salvation. I could feel like, wow, I felt like, yeah, I can see that body's useless. And you know, it was very potent, the feeling, like I can see it, I can see, quote unquote, I'm aware of it, you know, there's an awareness of freedom and happiness, but there's also the shock of hearing this, like, oh, wow, that's great, but it's also shocking. So this is the continuity issue that is all important to get to see this without falling into depression and suicidal depression. One has to practice the mood of repentance at all times, be very humble, and also accept that one has a severe continuity problem. That's the only problem that one has. That's it. There isn't anything else. Then you can remain in a positive frame of mind, even though there is this kind of dismay and some confusion and dismay, saying, well, bodies are useless, perception's useless. It's like, you can just say, okay, there's a continuity fear, means it's going to take a little while to accept this. I have this continuity problem, and I'm willing to give it some time to absorb the shock of this. Mood of repentance means I'm giving it some, a little bit of time. I'm patient with it. Now, it's one thing to see this for yourself. It's another thing to try to explain it. It's very difficult to explain. So don't worry if you don't do a good job of explaining right off the bat. It's another important issue here. It's more important to absorb the shock of the wow factor. Having heard it, you say, wow. See, oneness never requested that it be seen. Never requested that it be seen. Spirit wanted to experiment with oneness and wanted to be greater, wanted to see, can I be greater than, is it possible to be greater than oneness? Separate from oneness, is it possible? But oneness did not say, hey, I need to be seen. That is not true. Never, 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 never. So oneness is not waiting to be seen. Oneness is not waiting to be seen. Oneness is not waiting for anything. Oneness is not waiting for any perception to take place. It's already here. So oneness is not waiting for perception. This is very key. And once we can process this and accept it, then we are going to, the load of waiting, this feeling of needing to wait, is going to be lifted off our shoulders. It's going to be flushed away. Oneness is not waiting to be seen. Oneness is not demanding that it be seen. Not at all. We're projecting that on oneness. We're saying, well, I'm only doing this because oneness asked me to be seen. That's not true. Oneness needs to be seen. Not true. Oneness wants to be seen. Not true. There's no request whatsoever from oneness that it be seen or perceived. Knowing that this is ridiculous. And there's no reaction from oneness whatsoever to the attempt to see it. It's not defensive about it at all. No reaction. No request, no reaction. Oneness is not requesting to be seen. Which is why I say bodies are useless. There's no request to be seen. No request whatsoever from oneness. See, oneness doesn't require perception to be what it is. Doesn't need to be seen. When we experience oneness, we're not seeing it, we're knowing it. This is what is true. This is the truth. And then when we try to perceive it, it vanishes. So seems to vanish because we can't perceive it. So when we have these breakthroughs and we're knowing the oneness, we say, ah, I know this is true. Okay, now I get it. I'm aware of it. We can say I quote unquote see it, but that's just a word we're using. It's not perception. When we're aware of oneness, then we say, okay, now I know what it is. Now I have a better idea of what it is I need to see, or what it is I need to perceive. Gone. It vanishes. Because why are we doing that? We say, well, the body needs to see it. This is something the body needs to do. No, the body doesn't have any needs. That's a lie to say the body has needs. We're projecting those needs on the body. Spirit is the one that says it needs to see. That's not a need either. It's a desire to see oneness, to be greater than God. It's not a need. It's a desire. We say, well, if the body, see, when we say the body needs to see this, we say, well, if the body doesn't see it, it'll die. Not true, not true. That's, again, a projection on the body. The body doesn't have any need at all. No needs at all. Not really. The mind tries to establish needs for the body so it can claim it needs to see oneness. If it doesn't see oneness, it'll die. That is not so. So when we are aware of oneness, we don't need to then go back and say, hey body, you know, I know it's there to be seen, so come on, you need to work harder to see it. Here's a question. Can we find the end of nothing? Can we find the end of nothing? Or the end of time, which is the same thing? Can we find the end of what doesn't exist? We're searching to find where does nothing end? There is no end because there's no beginning. There is nothing there to find. We cannot find the end of what doesn't exist. The end of time. Can we find the end of time? No. Now, this... One could say, well, I'll get very depressed if I say I'm never going to be able to find the end of time. Very depressing. But keep in mind that there's no beginning of time. There isn't any such thing as time. That's why you can't find the end of it. So it's not like you'll just be endlessly stuck in what doesn't exist. How can we be endlessly stuck in what doesn't exist? And this is what led up to recognizing that we don't need to keep trying to perceive oneness that cannot be perceived. The whole spiritual path from the standpoint of the ego is to succeed in perceiving oneness, actually, to tell you the truth. Quote unquote. I'm always trying to convey the truth, but to be very blunt, I guess you'd say, all of our efforts, quote unquote efforts on the spiritual path, have been a delusion. We're trying to find something. We can't find oneness. Finding is a perceptual notion, is it not? Finding the end of something is also a perceptual notion, right? So we cannot find oneness. We cannot discover oneness. All our efforts to find oneness, that is the delusion. So you could say that the quote-unquote spiritual path is our delusion. Except the effort to recognize it as a delusion, which is the real spiritual path. But we get somewhat confused about it, for sure, which is why it's so difficult to come into this world and teach truth from the get-go, because those who've been on the path for a long time are very insist that they be honored, their efforts be honored, but their efforts are delusion, actually. So the reason why I was not able to successfully convey truth earlier in life was because of this massive pressure from the world, of those who have been seeking for so long and so much effort. They couldn't stand hearing that all that effort was a complete waste. It's like saying, waiting for time to end. You know, we're waiting for time to end. There is no time. How can you wait for time to end? Or seeking the end of time. There is no time. How can we find the end of time if there isn't any such thing as time? It's like trying to find the end of nothing. So the demand to honor these efforts, quote-unquote spiritual efforts, you know, set me back, wasted my life. The good news is I will be able to get my life back. Be able to get it back. This is a huge problem, coming into this world, where the delusion is so strong, is where people believe that the seeking to find oneness, the seeking and the to see it, is the spiritual path. And so they want that honored, and so it's just opposite. The seeking to see oneness is the ego. And we think, well, if we don't see it, we'll get so depressed, the body we need to see it, and that's not true. Nothing needs to see oneness. Oneness doesn't need to see oneness. Oneness is oneness. What is doesn't need to be seen. Everything is. But nothing needs to be seen. We're really trying to see nothing. And of course you can't see nothing. When we try to see, we're looking for nothing, actually. Because everything doesn't need to be seen, can't be seen. Oneness cannot be seen. So there's a demand that you wait until you're older, until share the truth, to honor all those who were spent a lifetime, searching. And so now I'm older, and I feel, well, maybe it's okay at this age, to say, okay, now I found the truth. But you don't find truth. You give up trying to find truth. Truth cannot be found. There's no path that leads to truth. There's no path that leads to seeing oneness. There's no path that leads to the perception of oneness. All those paths are just aimless wandering around, totally useless. So it's very difficult for someone who's young to come into this world and teach the truth. Very difficult. Because the overwhelming demand here is that you honor the efforts that have been made here. Of course, all those efforts are totally useless. Now, if the world was more in a mood of repentance, then they could absorb the shock of a young person telling them the truth. The young person would say, "Oh, everything you've tried is completely useless. You just wasted your entire, wasted all this time." But that, in the mood of repentance, that would be a wonderful yes. Like, "Oh, that's wonderful. That's great." Because you can see how you can get your life back, and your life is eternal. So the idea that, well, you've wasted your life, once you realize that you cannot perceive your life, life is not perceptible, then you have eternal life. So you trade death in for eternal life. So how is that, a bummer, So I was like, wow. You realize that life has always been. So you didn't miss life. You didn't miss out on it. It's still exactly as it is. It always has been. Life has not did not miss out on life. See, that's what you realize. Life has not missed out on life. That's what we're worried about. We think all this time that we spent trying to find life, that somehow life has been waiting for us to find it, and it hasn't been life during this time. That is not true. It's always been life. It has not been suffering at all. Life has not been suffering. Life has not been deprived. Life has not been needy. Life has not been waiting. That's the good news. See, we're all depressed thinking, wow, I've been depriving life of itself all this time. That's not true. That's like someone going to sleep, and then they think in their sleep, they think that somehow, the activity in life that's going on when they're sleeping, that they're somehow, that they're depriving, that that's not there. It's been deprived as they sleep. It's all deprived. It's not true. And they're afraid of waking up feeling so guilty, like, wow, I deprived you of all this life. No, it's not being deprived at all. It's the one that is sleeping is simply unaware. Just imagining that this deprivation is taking place. There's oneness is not being deprived of oneness. Oneness is life. It is no deprivation of oneness as we're trying to perceive it. I know this seems to be a little sketchy, but again, absorb the shock of it. There's shock value here. This is real shock treatment. Shock treatment, actually. You see, if a child were just here to say, "You know what? You've never deprived me of life. I've never been deprived of life." It's like, wow. the inner child, so to speak, meaning that which is never felt not wonderful, has never been deprived of that feeling. We failed to deprive ourselves of that feeling. So we're a failure at failure. We tried to get it to fail and it didn't fail. Life did not fail, oneness did not fail, even though we attempted. Now, our attempt to perceive oneness is our attempt to change oneness and say it's not one, there's something outside of it that's capable of perceiving it. A lot of mosquitoes, yeah. I got bit last night bad. So the real effort on the path is to absorb the shock of realizing that there is no path. There's never been a path. There is no path to what we are not. There is no path out of oneness. There's been aimless wandering around, but that's not a path. Definition of a path is something that leads somewhere. There's nowhere you can, nowhere, no path can lead you out of oneness, lead us out of oneness. No path can lead us to perception of oneness. And so as this song of salvation is, you hear this, it's shocking. Shock treatment. The Stone Age culture that we're in now demands that we constantly be in a non-repentant mood of fun, 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 fun. And when we say, hey, wait a minute, you know, I want to be, feel this shock and absorb it, what they want to be able to say is, oh, that you're having so much fun that this will interfere with your fun. See, it's interfering with your fun. You're doing something, right? You're always hyped up for fun, and they say we can't interfere with that, you'll lose the feeling of fun. Fun, what is fun here? Is it really fun? Not at all. It's a distraction. It's an excuse. We're simply generating excuses. This Stone Age culture we're in is simply generating excuses. It's simply a vast excuse-generating dynamic we have going on here in the world. That's all that it is. To justify the lack of repentance. And if you're not in the mood of repentance, how can you absorb the shock of realization that all of this has just been much ado about nothing, completely useless? Body's useless. Perception is useless. How can you absorb the shock of all this if you're not in a mood of repentance? And so we make these excuses that I need to be shopping, I need to be doing this, I need to be having fun. You know, anything other than the mood of repentance is basically what the world's saying. Anything but that. And so it generates all of this stuff needs. It says the body needs to be doing this, otherwise you're going to be unhappy. No, you'll be in the mood of repentance and you'll be momentarily stunned, but it's a positive stunning. It's like, wow, it's kind of like something that stuns us into awakening. But the mind claims the body has all these needs and needs to have fun. That's not true. It's the mind that's saying that. Body doesn't have any needs like that. It does not. You could say it needs to eat and sleep, but even those are projections. But we're not trying to push that issue at this point at all. But certainly, the idea the body has to have fun is a projection, an excuse. We say, well, the body has to be drinking all this wine and, you know, has to have all this special food and special wine and needs all this stuff. It had the body needs this. What we're trying to do is we're trying to cultivate the body so it can perceive oneness. So we keep saying, well, the body can't perceive oneness yet, so we need to develop it further. We need to enhance the body's capacities. We need to, you know, evolve the body's capacities. We need to evolve the capacity to perceive oneness. Useless. Totally useless. Utter nonsense. We will never evolve a means to perceive oneness. Never. Not even the slightest bit. We're just projecting those needs upon the body, saying the body needs to do this. What we're saying is we need to perceive oneness so that we can claim we're greater than God. And the body is just this device we're using. Because obviously, being spirit, we cannot perceive. So we claim, well, it's the body is going to perceive. The body's the hero. The body's our savior, is what we say. Body's our savior. We just need to evolve it so it becomes more and more perceptive. So therefore, we can train the body to perceive the difference between 100,000 different wines. You know, I can't be in the mood of repentance. I got to get the right bottle of wine. That's what I need. I need to train the body. Say, okay, this wine is really great. This one is not so great. You know, in other words, capacity to perceive what is better and better and better and better and better, so it can finally perceive oneness. The body doesn't have any such needs. The body doesn't need to do anything. Body is essentially just useless, completely useless. All body is useless. The world is useless. Totally useless. All of this is completely useless. Now, to the extent that we can see that and absorb the shock of it, then that's beneficial to us, to our true happiness, knowing that happiness cannot be diminished in any way, cannot be perceived. So it's not dependent on perception. So our happiness is not dependent on the body at all. It has nothing to do with the body. Body neither makes it possible, nor does it detract from it in any way. It cannot detract from it in any way. Our happiness is totally independent of perception. Perception plays no role in it whatsoever, none. And except, of course, I have a severe continuity fear, so it may seem for a while as if perception seems to be playing some role as I gradually get used to that. I don't need to even believe that anymore. So there's because of the continuity fear, there's always this soft landing issue. But we understand we don't need to argue about or think about or anything. Just whatever, however the soft landing occurs, that is fine. Not worried about it. So the key is to not let your thoughts start ricocheting all over the place. Just sort of let this shock melt, mellow out a little bit. Let the shock mellow out. And as it does, then the song of salvation will be heard even stronger. But we go through a phase of saying, well, wait a minute, I got to get used to this. I got to get over the shock of this. And then we can listen to the song even stronger, even more clearly, which is what we really want. We want to be able to really listen to it very clearly and hear it very clearly and continuously. It's important to see, realize, accept, be aware of that there isn't, quote unquote, anyone in oneness that's seeing oneness. There isn't some seer of oneness. No one sees oneness. There's the idea that if you go to see a great sage, that they finally succeeded. We believe, oh, here's someone who's finally succeeded how to see oneness. I need to go to them. And they will teach me how to see oneness. That is delusion. That is the delusion. There is no seer of oneness. There isn't any seeing of oneness. There isn't anyone in oneness that is a seer of oneness. There's only the oneness that is known. Oneness is only known. So there is no hero, there is no hero, there is no exceptional, there is no special one in oneness. There is no special one. There is no specialness. So you could say, well, I failed to be a seer. How can we fail to do what's impossible? We failed at failure, but failure is impossible. Oneness cannot fail to be what it is. So, the idea is that somehow if we get the body to see oneness, then we'll go to heaven and be saved and all that. That's nonsense. We're never not in heaven. It's just trying to see, perceive oneness puts us into this deep sleep of delusion. That there needs to be then a seer of oneness. So all of this runs counter to the ego's training, to how we've trained ourselves, to believe, all the belief training that we've done. But it's also, we recognize it is true. This is true. So there's that shock. Wow. We're shocking the Shakti, is what we're doing. The Shakti is the searching. The desire to search, desire to perceive oneness is the Shakti, the energy to the so-called energy of perception, the attempt to perceive. All of this is Shakti, is the energy to try and perceive, the dance of perception. There is no perception. It's nothing. It's a presumption. The dad's subconsciousness is just a projection, presumption, assumption, a belief, a mirage. There's always only just the oneness. There's always just only the oneness. There's always just that. There's no perceiver of that. There's no perceiver of that. You see, that's why they say, I am that. I'm not perceiving that. I am that. There's no perception of it. There's no perceiver. There's no perceiver. I am that. The perceiver is a reflection of our desire to be greater than that. To be greater than I am that. To be greater than God, greater than reality. So we might say, well, I'm giving up greatness. No, because we cannot be greater than God. So we're not giving up greatness. We are greatness. We are oneness. We are greater than greatness. We're glory, endless glory. The impossible is not great. We can't say it's a great impossibility. See, if we start trying to put terms on it, what's impossible, it makes it seem less than impossible, right? Something other than impossible. There's no such thing as a great impossibility. Impossibility is nothing. It's totally impossible. So, in these sort of breaks, quiet breaks of what's going on with me, a bunch of thoughts? No, not a bunch of thoughts. It's like just wow. Sort of a reverberation, sort of a stunned reverberation. It's like, you know, sort of momentarily stunned, sort of a stunned feeling. Or you could say an unstunned feeling. You see, the ordinary fun of the world, that is being in a stunned condition, actually. Super stunned condition. The feeling I'm having now is awakening from that stunned condition. Now, because of the definitions, we think that fun and the functionality of the body, that's the opposite of being stunned. Therefore, by definition, what I'm feeling now must be stunned, but it's not really the case. I'm being unstunned, actually. Coming out of being stunned into searching for attempting to perceive oneness. Coming out of that is an unstunning. It's like when you're asleep and dreaming and you think you're awake, and then you try to start to wake up, you say, whoa, I think I'm falling into a dream. No, we're awakening from the dream. But it's easy to have that confusion, like, wait a minute, which is the dream and which is awakening? I'm not quite sure, right? There's that phase, that in-between phase, which is the whole tricky part of what we call the spiritual path. The real path is this tricky part of continuity fear, not sure what is waking, what is asleep, what is being stunned, and what is not being stunned. And there's a time of confusion, which is why you have to use an effort of will to give the benefit of the doubt to the Holy Spirit, to truth, and accepting you're going to feel what you think is being stunned for a while, and then own it, embrace it, say, okay, and be humble, because you're thinking, well, I'm not out there having fun right now, I'm feeling stunned. But actually it's the ones who are going out having fun who are trying to stun themselves. That's the stun. Because they're trying to perceive oneness. They're trying to succeed at failure. So they're constantly stunning themselves. And the stunned feeling that like I'm feeling is partially because I say, okay, now wait a minute, how do I get back to having fun? We call trying to perceive oneness fun. It's not fun, it's suffering. So it's really saying, well, okay, how do I get back to suffering now? Because this morning I saw very clearly indeed. I even got a tinge of what it feels like. You know, I could just a very slight, distant tinge say, oh, okay, this is the happiness that is there, that is always here. You know, once I drop the seeking, the perceiving. And now it's like saying, okay, well, how do I get back to suffering? You know, how do I find my way back to suffering from this? The truth is we don't need to find a way back to suffering. Once we can accept that, we don't need to find a way back to suffering, then there isn't any feeling of being stunned, really. But until then, we need to look at it as this continuity fear where we're not quite sure. So we need to accept we're going to this feeling of being stunned, and don't try to escape from it, because the escape from it is by default, it's into more stunnedness. You see, we say, wow, I'm feeling kind of stunned. As we try to depart from this momentary peak of seeing vision of oneness, of being aware of it, to go back into seeking for it, trying to perceive it, then we start to say, well, how do I get re-stunned? You know, how do I re-stun myself? How do I get back into suffering? And then we pursue fun, and all the stuff we're used to. But if we say, hold it, whoa, I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to sit here in the stunnedness of it and not try to make it more stunned. Let me just accept a little bit of being stunned. Then, you see, we do not depart so far away from the song of salvation, song of freedom, song of oneness. We remain close to it so we can hear it again. I'm aware of my mind saying, okay, how do I get back into suffering? Okay, well, you need to do this and this and this and this and that. You know, say, come on, let's get back into suffering. In other words, get back into trying to perceive oneness. And of course, it's presenting it as fun. Go out and play some golf, you know. Go out to a restaurant. Go out and have some fun, is basically what the ego's saying. Go out, now that you've had this real tough, you know, gone through this real tough suffering, go out and have some fun. Meaning, go out and immerse yourself in suffering. In other words, double down on suffering. So you don't feel the previous suffering so much because you're in even deeper suffering. It's a stupid thing, isn't it? Stupid. This state may feel more acute right at the moment, suffering, because I'm not used to being less stunned. It's unfamiliar. So the unfamiliarity of it makes us feel jittery. That's why you have to have this discipline to stick with it. Stick with the jitters. Don't rush into trying to double down on suffering, because you have less suffering now. So you're feeling jitters about this is unusual. It says, wow, this is very unusual. I'm not so stunned anymore. And so feeling less stunned than normal in itself is stunning. You see what I'm saying here? And this is why you have to give yourself time to absorb this and accept and say, okay, I feel less stunned now, much less stunned. So the stunnedness of being less stunned wears off. That's the continuity issue. There's really no way around that. I'm stunned that I'm less stunned, is a way to put it. I'm really stunned that I'm less stunned. Wow, I'm stunned that I don't need to be stunned. That's another way. I'm feeling very stunned that I realize I don't need to be stunned. Yeah, that's... But the benefit of sticking with this is you accept that you don't need to be stunned. Or stunted. You don't have to believe in stunted life. Stunted life is our attempt to perceive life. Then we imagine that life is stunted and that we're the saviors, that once we perceive it, it will no longer be stunted. See, that's the delusion. That somehow life has been stunted and our perception will set it free. And we're the saviors of life. Life doesn't need any savior. Life is not in need of a savior or a hero. This is all our delusion. Justifies trying to perceive oneness is saying oneness is stunted. No, it's the attempt to perceive oneness that stunts our awareness. Or at least imagines that our awareness is stunted. And so gives us this belief we have to save, we're the saviors. We need to save life by perceiving it. Once we perceive it, that will save life. We'll no longer be stunted. So I'm stunned that I don't need to be. I see I don't need to be stunned. That's very stunning. But conscious of it. See, stay conscious of it. I'm stunned that I don't need to be stunned. This is great meditation. And this obviously can resolve. Because we gradually say, I'm not so stunned that I don't need to be stunned. And should I perceive? Do I need to perceive my happiness? No. Does happiness need to be perceived? Don't say, do I need to perceive it? There's an assumption, there's a perceiver there, but there's only perception. I mean, the question is, does happiness need to be perceived? Is maybe a better way to look at it. The I is just an assumption that there's a need to perceive happiness. And so that there's a need for a hero there to do the perceiving that will be the savior of happiness, of oneness. No, there is no such need. Happiness does not need to be perceived. So this is very stunning. Stunned that I don't need to be stunned. Happiness does not need to be perceived. Wow. So there's no need for a perceiver, I, is there? The notion of perceiver. No need to project an identity as a perceiver. Again, I'm just in a wordlessly stunned condition. If happiness doesn't need to be perceived, then It's everywhere, isn't it? Timeless, everywhere. Location free, time free. Because a perceiver implies a location for what's being perceived, does it not? Perception and implies that it was not perceived before. So a change. But if happiness doesn't need to be perceived, what do we need time for? What do we need space for? Time and space and perception are all one, go together. This is a heavy one. This is great. Very stunning. So just let the stun be there. Don't try to make it more, thinking that you'll be more successful. Don't try to make it more, don't try to make it less. Just keep your stride going. If you have to stop and pause a moment, that's fine. Happiness doesn't need to be perceived. That's really profound. So it's more important to process the shock of this than it is to try and figure it out intellectually or analytically. That's why it's very important to not be hyped up when you're looking for truth. Do not be intellectually hyped up, because if you're on drugs or coffee or something that's stimulating the mind, stimulating the intellect, then what you'll do is say, okay, let me try to, figure this out intellectually. It's way more important to just simply abide with this stunned feeling. I'm stunned that I don't need to be stunned. I'm stunned that I don't need to be unhappy. I'm a little bit unhappy that I don't need to be unhappy, kind of thing, right? It's like that. Oh, I'm unhappy that I don't need to be unhappy. I'm stunned that I don't need to be stunned. Because this is a feeling. So once this feeling, we can work through it. Because it's really a feeling of letting go of not feeling happiness. So Because remember, we've misdefined things upside down. We think that all the pursuit of happiness, of fun in the world, is happiness. It's not, it's the opposite. It's misery, it's suffering. It's super stunness. So as we come out of that, we're apt to misdefine it and think, oh, I'm going away from happiness now. I'm going into this stunned feeling. No, I'm awakening from being feeling stunned, and that's stunning in itself. So this is the continuity fear that I keep trying to keep bringing up, is awakening from a dream might seem as if you're going into a dream, but it's not. You have to be aware of that. Coming out of feeling stunned may seem stunning, but it's temporary. One moment. So we consciously accept the temporary, quote-unquote, stunness. I'm stunned that I don't need to be stunned. I'm stunned that I'm coming out of my being stunned. Like that. Now, of course, it may seem stupid to others. They say, well, hey, if you don't want to feel stunned, then go have some fun. You say, no, that is the stun, being stunned. You say, go be happy, find some happiness. You say, no, happiness doesn't need to be perceived. It cannot be perceived, and certainly doesn't need to be perceived. I don't need to perceive happiness. It's everywhere. I don't need to find it. I don't need to go find happiness. I don't need to go find oneness. How can we find oneness? Don't need to find anything. I don't need to find anything. And we're used to pushing the body. Come on, body. You need to find stuff. Come on. Go, body. And I realize we don't need to push the body at all. Now we can still move the body about, but it's not from a sense of pushing. By pushing the body about, the body just floats along with us, actually. Yeah, it's more like just the body is simply floating along. Wherever we go, it floats along with us. We're not pushing the body. Not being pushed along, it's floating along. So we go from a heavy feeling of we're pushing this push the body to a floating feeling, like weightless floating feeling. Just the body's weightless, just floating along with us. When we realize the body doesn't need to do anything, then it's in this floating mode, actually. Floating mode. Weightless mode. Feels light as a feather. It doesn't mean it's strong, it just means it's floating as light as a feather. Feels light as a feather. Doesn't mean it can lift a building up. the way to lift a building up is to realize a building doesn't need to be a building. Don't need to perceive happiness. Don't need to do anything. Then everything is as light as a feather. Everything is just floating. Nothing is being pushed. The push off of everything. Push implies resistance, does it not? So the more resistance there is, the harder we have to push, the more we think we're trying to perceive happiness. Happiness cannot be perceived. I don't need to perceive happiness. So when trying and making the efforts to recognize and accept, this is very important to be in a humble mood of repentance without having stimulating the thinking, analyzing, action mode. So you can just quietly stay with the shock of not needing shock. The stunness of not needing stunness. The unhappiness of not needing unhappiness. So you can get used to that feeling and say, hey, it's not so bad. I can even set this down without, I can set it all down without feeling stunned. You know, you just get used to it without trying to manipulate it intellectually. In any way. Pay the price. There's the price you pay. Just paying the price here. I can just sit here for a long time, absorbing all this. But this is just a good example of how it's done. Okay, very great, that's it.